Cisco Certified Network Associate Day 5. I'm Imran Rafai, your trainer for this entire series. Today we're going to talk about connecting Cisco devices, and we'll finish this video by looking at iOS and the different modes of iOS. So without wasting much time, let's get straight in. For those people who are starting with Cisco, this must be the first time they are actually seeing a Cisco device. Now, this is a 1921 Cisco router. How do you know this is a router? One of the first things that you can know this is a router is by seeing a power switch. Remember, Cisco switches do not have a power switch. Another thing is, a switch would have a lot of ports, because it is a switch, so it needs to connect, so it would have either 12 ports or 24 ports. A router would typically have two gigabit Ethernet ports, maybe a couple of fast Ethernet ports. Of course, you see this space is for extra module, so you could insert a switching module onto this, but normally you would just have a port. So that's how you identify this is a router. Of course, you as a CCNA, you would need to know what is a router, what are the series, router series, what are the switch series, but that's for a different discussion altogether. All the Cisco devices would have these two ports common. You would have a console port labeled with a light blue console label, and then you would have an aux port. Now, both these ports are meant for something known as the out-of-band configuration. Now, out-of-band access to a device means that you can access the device even when the operating system is not up. So literally, you could see the boot process. Now, if you compare it with your computer, most of us would have had a chance to help a cousin or a friend or a family member with a computer issue. So he would call in or she would call in and say that their computer is not working, and you would remote, using, you know, maybe TeamViewer or any of these remote control tools, you would connect to their computer and try to solve something, and then you install a software and the computer says it needs to restart. Now, you can hit restart, but the minute the computer goes off, your access to the computer is dead and you wouldn't be able to see anything that happened. So you literally have to rely on whatever that cousin or a friend tells you over phone of what he's seeing. So if that installation did not work, and if the computer actually goes into an error state, there's no way you can know other than to rely on your friend's inputs of what exactly is happening. And as an IT person, you want to actually get into the action. You want to see what is happening before you take a decision, right? So out-of-band access is a process where you would actually be able to remotely see the boot process. You would be able to see the BIOS. You could get into the BIOS settings. You could check all those things. That is out-of-band access. Now, console port is something like that. You could actually connect to the console port and you can see the switcher start or the router start. You can actually see the boot process. You can see everything before the operating system is loaded. Now, what's the difference between a console port and aux port? Console port is if you sit next to the device, you take a console cable, which is a crossover cable, which has RJ45 connector at one end and a serial connector at the other end. You connect it to a computer and you start working on the device. Now, aux port is similar function, but you normally connect it to a modem, and it's normally it is used as a backup to get out of band access to this device. Right. The problem with this blue color console cable is it makes use of serial port. Now, most of today's computers do not have a serial port. So what we need to make use of is a serial to USB converter, like the one you see on the left. Now, once you install this converter, once you plug this end, the male serial connector to the female serial connector, and connect the USB port to your computer, you would need to install a USB to serial driver, right? When you install the USB to serial driver, it also installs a COM port onto your computer. And then you can use any terminal software and connect it to your device. Now, that was then. The latest, the new Cisco devices come with a USB port. So if you can see, it is also labeled in blue, which means that this is also console USB port. What that means is you could literally use a regular USB cable with the mini USB on one side and regular USB on the other side and connect to your computer. But Cisco also gives you a driver, a Cisco Windows USB driver. What literally it does is it creates a COM port on your computer, and then you can use a terminal software like we will be seeing in the next slide and connect to the device. Now, every router will also have, like I discussed, you'll have a gigabit Ethernet port and fast Ethernet port. These are regular interfaces which you connect to other networking devices and form your network. You also see another USB port here. Now, this USB port, like we will be discussing when we deal with the routers in later part of this series, is used to transfer the IOS images. So the difference between this USB and this USB, this one and this one, is just that this is console USB and this is to use your external storage just to save your IOS images. Basically, in this video, what you need to know is only about console. Don't worry about all the others. We will be discussing it in depth when we look at switches and routers in later part of the series. All you need to know in this video is about the console cable and how a console cable is connected. Right, after connecting the device using the console crossover cables and the console ports, we need to make use of a terminal software. Now, there are four popular terminal softwares. The most popular is PuTTY. PuTTY is a free version. You can go to putty.org. PuTTY or PuTTY, I don't know how they pronounce, but different people pronounce it different ways. So I prefer calling it PuTTY, but some people say PuTTY, but it's up to you. Whatever you want, you can call it. So if you go to PuTTY.org or PuTTY.org, you can download a free version of PuTTY. Then we have TeraTerm. We also have Hyperterm, which used to come free on Windows, but I think the newer versions of Windows from Windows 7 onwards, they have discontinued. These three, PuTTY, TeraTerm and Hyperterm, are free versions. We have another beautiful software called a Secure CRT, which I'm a big fan of. Since I've started using Secure CRT, trust me, I've never looked back or looked into any other terminal software. But like I said, it is up to you. Whatever you're comfortable in, please feel free to use, right? Right, so every terminal software has this basic configuration options. Now, what you would need to do is choose serial as your connection type. The speed, this is standard speed for connecting all Cisco devices, is 9600. And we need to choose which serial line we connect into. So if your computer has a serial interface, most likely it'll be COM1. But let's assume you don't. You had to install a serial to USB converter or the new USB port on the device. In whichever case, you install a driver to get a virtual COM port, right? Now, to know which COM port you're getting connected to, all you need to do is go to the device manager. There are different ways to go to device manager. You could right click on my computer and choose device manager. If you're on Windows 8, or you could do Windows X and there is device manager option. We have different ways of going to device manager. So once you go to device manager, you can go to ports, COM and LPT, and you can see which COM port you're connected to. If it is COM1, put COM1 here and click open. It will open up your terminal session. Now that's very easy. So once you connect that and once you launch your terminal session and put the configuration that we saw on the previous slide, you would go into the boot up process. So when you connect your terminal, you would see the iOS image decompressing. After the iOS image decompresses, it goes through something called as the POST, that is power on self test. Then it outputs all these information regarding the declaration, restrictions, and all those things, usage rights, usage copyright information, and all this information is output here. And then it gives some information regarding the hardware of the device, and of course it also gives you information regarding the version. So in this case we're using version 15.1. And finally it will go into the configuration dialog. Now every device, if you use Cisco switches or Cisco router, you would get this command prompt. One piece of advice: always say no. Why do you say no? Because most of the configuration that this dialog process or this wizard takes you is unsupported. So there's no point you go in and configure all those information there, because most of them are not supported today. The best way is to say no and go through the command line, as we would be doing today and in this entire series, right? So the first command or the first mode that any device logs into is known as the user exec mode. Now this mode is the lowest privilege. So at this mode, the user, whoever is connected to, has the least privilege. Now how do you know this is the user exec mode? You know this is the user exec mode by seeing this greater than sign or angular bracket, whatever you call it. So when you see that, you know you're at the user exec mode. One thing about Cisco IOS is you hit the question mark, it will tell all the supported commands at that particular mode, right? So in this mode, these are the only commands that you have. So maybe you could give this, right? I mean, this is like the basic access to the device. So you, maybe the call send executive could come in and then just see the status of interface brief. So they could just look at the interface status, and they could, depending on what the status is, they could raise a ticket to the higher level up, who would have more higher access. So this is the lowest access available. You can see that by saying show privilege. Sorry, you can see that by doing show privilege, and you see that the privilege level is 1. Next we go into something called as the privilege exec mode. Now to go into that, we type enable. Remember, another beautiful thing about the Cisco IOS is you can just type shortcuts. Now if you see, I type show privy, actually to show privilege, but Cisco IOS is intelligent, so it just sees that there's no other word matches privy, and it knows it is privilege, and it accepts privilege. So if I type E and if I do tab, it will not right, because there are two commands starting with E: enable and exit. So if I go, if I type in the minimum required letters by which Cisco IOS can differentiate between these two words and hit tab, it will actually type the whole word. So I can just say enable, I can see EN and do tab, it'll do enable, or I could just say EN and enter, it will accept the command as enable. Now that's the beauty of iOS, Cisco iOS, and that is what made Cisco such a popular operating system across the networking industry. Right, so when you see hash, you know that you're in the privilege exec mode. At privilege exec mode, you are basically at the highest privilege available to any Cisco user. So if I do show privilege, it is at privilege level 15, which is the highest privilege level assigned to anybody. So this level, if you see, if you do a question mark, you see that at this level you have so many more commands than the commands that was available in the user exec mode. So at this, from this mode, you could go into the global configuration mode, you could save configurations, you could read configuration, you can delete the configuration, you could do a lot of things that you could not do part of the user exec mode. Right, the next mode is the global configuration mode. How do you go there? You go there by typing conf configure terminal. Now when I say configure terminal, you could see that the prompt is changed from router hash to router config hash. Now when you see config, you know it is the global config mode. Now global config mode is the mode from where you make system wide changes. Suppose let's say you want to change the host name of this device, you would say host name NetworKing, right? And if you can see, the host name is changed from router to NetworKing. So any system-wide changes you would change here. This is where you would change system-wide changes. From here, you can go to different levels. So let's say, so this was the use exec mode and you could do all these things. Then you go to privilege exec mode, you do all these things. Then you go to global configuration mode where you can do system-wide changes, or you could go into one of those sub-interfaces, I mean sub-commands, where interface command, router commands, line commands, and all these things you do at that level. Right, so from here you type interface. Let's say you go in, you want to configure an IP address for your gigabit Ethernet interface. So you say interface gigabit Ethernet 0/0 and you can configure. Now if you see, the prompt has changed to NetworKing config IF, and I know that if it is config IF, it is in one of the interface commands. So whatever changes you make here is gonna apply to that particular interface only. So if you do question mark here, you would see different commands like IP, IPv6, MAC address, priority, shutdown, PPPoE, bandwidth, CDP, crypto. All these commands are relevant only to the interface. Similarly, you could do exit. Exit will take you back to one step higher. So we are back in the global config mode. Here, maybe you can do router RIP. This is the configuration for the routing protocol, RIP. And whatever, if you see the prompt, it says config router. I know this is the router configuration mode. And whatever changes that I make here is relevant only to this routing protocol. Now, if you do question mark, I would see commands that is relevant for the routing configuration, right? So this is how you configure different modes. Don't worry about the commands now, because the main aim of this video was only to show you the different levels and the rights that you have at different levels in Cisco IOS. Now when we do in the later part of the series, when we do routers, when we do switches, we would be going in depth into these different commands. We may not be touching all the commands, because all the commands are not part of your CCNA curriculum, but we would be looking at a lot of commands that is relevant for your CCNA exams, right? So I think we have covered everything that I thought I should cover in this video. So thank you so much for watching. If you have any question regarding today's video, feel free to write into me at imran.rafai@nwking.org, or please feel free to comment on the sections below. And like I've always told you, please subscribe to us, share our videos, and do not forget to like this video. The more you share, the more people see this video, and the more people see this video, the more people benefit. So you guys are all part of this company. So thank you so much for the love and support that you've shown. God bless you.